So thank you, Frédéric. So I will give a recap of what's new since the last Free Fem Days last year. And so this is thanks to the help and input of many people. So some physicists from Nantes and from Saclay, applied mathematicians, computer scientists, and so on. So thank you for all your help and interesting feedbacks. So the talk will be mainly divided in two parts. In the first part, I will give a quick outlook of the new functionalities that we've been adding since last year. And so in the third part, I will give some applications of the new functionalities. And all of this is basically kind of a sneak peek into this afternoon's and tomorrow's afternoon's expert tutorial sessions. Okay, so a quick introduction about FreeFem and more importantly, its parallel interface. So basically you know that in FreeFem you have access to many different tools to do finite elements. And so the basic functionalities are all, let's say, sequential, okay? So FreeFem, as Frédéric said, is a domain-specific language for finite elements. And so when you think about finite element, what you need to have at hand is basically a mesh structure. You need to be able to define associated finite element spaces. And then on those finite element spaces, you may be interested in assembling vectors, matrices, and eventually do some kind of algebraic operations like matrix vector product or linear system solves, okay? So I will try to give you some examples. And so just to reiterate what Frédéric said on his fish, I will try to do a simple example really quickly just to show you. Okay, so as I said, when you do finite element, the first thing you need is a mesh structure. So you've seen that in FreeFem, you've seen that in FreeFem you can do this using the mesh command, okay? Mesh, for example, I will do a square, not a fish. Let's say something like that, okay? Then you need to have associated finite element space. So in FreeFem, you've seen that you have the keyword which is called F space, okay? So I will call my finite element space VH, for example, okay? Then you need to do vector and matrix assemblies. And so for that, as Frédéric highlighted, you need to define variational formulations. So FreeFem is based on weak forms. And so I will just define a really simple Poisson problem or Laplacian. And so I will just go really fast because it's something that you probably already know, but basically you write the weak form of your Poisson equation. Okay. Okay, so this is the bilinear form. Then you have your linear form. So I will just assume a constant source term of one, okay? And then you add your Dirichlet boundary condition. So let's assume that on one, u equals zero, okay? And so now you can do your actual vector and matrix assemblies. And so in FreeFem, you can do that by defining a matrix. Okay, so the matrix is of size, the number of degrees of freedom in your finite element space. And then you can define solution vectors and right-hand side. And you can do your finite element assemblies using the FreeFem domain-specific language, using your variational formulation and your two finite element spaces. And the same for the right-hand side, okay? And so if you want to do algebraic operation, you can do, for example, as in MATLAB, something like backslash. Okay. And so what's nice about FreeFem is that you can do some online visualization. So for example, TH, U, and okay. So this is just a quick sneak peek into FreeFem++. Of course, you'll see more about this this afternoon and tomorrow afternoon. And so this is the Poisson equation on a square. Okay. So this is really simple, really the basics of Prefem. And now basically the idea is to build on this sequential script to do some parallel computing to improve the efficiency of your script. Okay, so one way to do parallel computing in Prefem is to actually use the SLEPSI, the PETSI interface. So PETSI is a large library mainly developed in the US, and it basically can be used to install a lot of additional libraries. And so when you use PETSI inside Prefem, we actually use the PETSI installation to build for you a couple of additional libraries. So for example, if you don't have access to an MPI library, which is used to do the parallel computing, we install this for you. If you don't have CMake, we install this for you. If you don't have BLAS, we install this for you through PETSI. And then there are a couple of linear solvers and graph partitioner. So for example, MEMS, SuperLU distributed, SuperLU sequential, SuitSparse, Hyper, and then for the graph partitioner, you have Metis, Parmetis, Scotch. If you want to do mesh generation, we have TedGen installed through PETSI. And for eigenvalue solver, we install SLEPSI and RPAC through PETSI. And there is also HPDDM, which is a collection of domain decomposition preconditioner. So all those tools can be either installed by Prefem, or you can have PETSI install them for you via Prefem. Okay, so this is something to keep in mind. And I always prefer to install those libraries via PETSI because it's usually more up to date, let's say. So if you, for example, let Prefem install MEMS for you, it can be quite an old version. Whereas if you install it through PETSI, it will be much more a much more recent version. So there is also MMJ and ParMMJ that are being currently integrated inside PETSI. So I'm actually leading the integration. So if you have questions or if you have some inputs, please let me know. But basically, those are all the tools that you can access through PETSI inside Prefem. So what's important is that you can access these tools either in sequential or in parallel. The only difference in how you launch your script is that instead of using Prefem++, you need to use Prefem++ MPI, and I will give you some more details afterward, but I will just show you actually how easy it is. So you can just, for example, go back to your original script, okay? So this is your Laplacian. And so if you want to use some kind of PETSI preconditioner or whatever, you just need to do load PETSI, okay? And so in PETSI, instead of having, so when you load PETSI, you can define both metrics, which are standard Prefem metrics, or you can use MAT, which are PETSI matrices, okay? And so this should be sufficient to actually run the script. And there you go. So instead of having Prefem solve the linear system for you, you have PETSI solve the linear system for you. And so this is in sequential, for now no parallel computing, but this can be interesting, for example, if you want to see how a multigrid solver works. Even in sequential, you can do something like PC type hyper, okay? And so this will use a multigrid preconditioner instead of using an LU preconditioner. And so you can say, for example, KSP monitor, which will monitor the convergence of your multigrid preconditioner. Okay, so you can see that, again, the Poisson problem is solved nicely. And this time, instead of using an LU preconditioner, you have an iterative solve. Okay, I see that there are a lot of questions, a lot of chat. No problem. Okay, so this is sequential, but this can, so at a minimal cost, let's say, you just need to add load PETSI and rename your matrix to a MAT. With a minimal cost, you can try fancy stuff like iterative solver if you want to solve large problem and you see that an LU solver is not converging very well, is too memory demanding, sorry, and so on and so forth. Okay. So if you want to go parallel, in Prefem we use the distributed memory paradigm. So this is MPI, the message passing interface. And so what you have to keep in mind basically is that you'll have multiple processes running on your computer and they need to exchange information one with another, okay? So in Prefem, for now, we've made the decision to not make it transparent to the users. So you'll have to add additional lightweight macros to actually take care of all the distributed memory machinery, but you'll see that it can be done quite easily. And so, for example, I will show you what this gives on this script. So if you use Swift M++ MPI, for example, with more than one process, you can do this like that. So MPI run or FFMPI and dash N 4. So this will run 4 instance of FreeFM MPI. And so in this script, I've not done anything to make the script parallel. So in fact, what this will do is solve 4 times the exact same problem with no parallel computing. So it's not really smart to do that, okay? But this is just to show you that basically here we solve 4 times the same problem on 4 processes. And so if you want to do actual parallel computing, it's all, again, really simple. You just need to load an additional file, which is called macro DDM. Okay, so this will take care of doing the domain decomposition for the message passing interface machinery. And you need to tell to FreeFM, okay, I want to decompose my problem on multiple processes. And so this is done through a little macro again, which is called create mat, which will actually assemble a parallel matrix. Okay. Oops, sorry. So you need to give the mesh and you need to do to say, okay, I want to do a P1 problem. Okay. And so now you can solve the problem. You should be able to solve the problem in parallel. Okay. And so here you see, oh, okay, this does not look like my mesh, my initial mesh, which was a square. And that's because FreeFM Parallel only access the FFGLUT through one process, which is the process 0, okay? And so if you want to have a parallel plot, you can just modify again slightly your little script. And so you need to, instead of having plot, you need to do a distributed plot. So I call this plot D. And so this should plot my problem in parallel. Okay, so we have the Poisson problem solved on 4 process. And so you can see here the domain decomposition. And basically what I want to show you is how easy it is to just take a sequential script, add a couple of small instruction, and then solve the problem in parallel. Okay. Okay, so back to the slides. So now you have a quick picture of how to use PETSI through FreeFM. And so I will present some of the newest functionalities. What's important to keep in mind is that you can have a list of the current examples that are using PETSI on either GitHub or your distribution. So just to show you on GitHub, so you need to go to the FreeFM website and then you can click on source code. Okay, so this will take you to FreeFM GitHub. You go to FreeFM sources. My script is too huge, so the sources are not there. Oh, there they are. You need to go to examples, HPDDM. Okay, and then you have a file readme.md. And so you have access to all the examples. So for example, diffusion2D, EAT, diffusion with periodic boundary condition, balancing domain decomposition with constraints, so on and so forth. So there are a lot of linear problems, Maxwell, geometric multigrid. Then there are non-linear problems. Then there are time steppers and optimizers and eigenvalue problems. Okay. And so as Frederic said in the beginning of his talk, there is also a changelog.md which gathers all the new functionalities. So if, for example, you update your script and something breaks down, a good place to look at is inside changelog.md because maybe we have changed the name of one function or something like that. So when it comes to PETSI and SLEPSI, what's important to keep in mind is that developments are really user-driven. So Petsy and Slepsy have much more developers than FreeFM, and so there is much more stuff than in FreeFM. And so if you need a routine which is inside Petsy or Slepsy, just ask us and we will take care of it and make the appropriate link between the two libraries. Okay, so one of the interesting stuff in that we've added since last year, which is actually not related to Petsy, but more like related directly to FreeFM, is parallel interpolation. So again, in FreeFM, all the kernels are basically sequential unless you go to Petsy. And so those kernels, for example, are the interpolation between different finite element space. So in this slide, you can see, for example, two squares, one square with a hole and slightly rotated. And so I'm assuming that I'm doing domain decomposition or parallel computing on those two meshes, okay? And so for example, let's assume that I'm doing some kind of shape optimization problem. And so I start with a square mesh and then my algorithm tells me, okay, I need to move the mesh and rotate it and create a new hole in the middle, okay? So you may want to have a solution interpolated from your original decomposition to your new distribution. And so, for example, let's assume that your original distribution is something like a product of cosine and sine, okay? And so if you are on the original red domain, you have this local function. And if you interpolate naively in your FreeFM script, you'll get something on the new red domain, which is completely rubbish because FreeFM extends does interpolation by continuity. And so, of course, the two domains are not nested into one into another, and so FreeFM does not know how to get the correct value on the original decomposition. Okay, so we've added parallel interpolation, which basically is in charge of doing this interpolation correctly, and so the algorithm we use is quite naive, but it works. So we first start by detecting intersecting subdomains from the old decomposition. From the old decomposition to the new decomposition. So on the left-hand side, you have the new decomposition, and on the right-hand side, you have the old decomposition. And so you can see that the red subdomain intersects with the green, the blue, the orange, and the red subdomain, okay? So once you know the list of intersecting subdomains, you can basically have all the intersecting subdomains send their local solution. And so what we do is basically we do a neighborwards reduction. So we gather all the solution from the intersecting subdomains, okay? And we sum the contribution, okay? And so now you have the solution on the old mesh, which is correctly known on the new subdomain. And so you can just do a plain sequential interpolation on your new decomposition. Okay, and this is what you get. Okay, and of course the two mesh are not necessarily nested or conforming, but this is done by the sequential FreeFM kernel. So there is a, just like the sequential FreeFM kernel, you can either transfer a single finite element function, or you can call, you can have a parallel mat, which is like the sequential matrix that you get if you call interpolate, which is a keyword in FreeFM to compute an interpolation matrix to go from one FS space to another. And so what is important is that we've put in all the machinery to call Petsy multigrid machinery, for example, for doing geometric multigrid. So here is an example where you have two meshes which are not Cartesian, and so they have rather nasty borders. And so, of course, one mesh is not nested in another. So you have a coarse mesh with 0.3 million elements. The fine mesh has 5 million elements. And so we have a matrix to go from the coarse to the fine mesh. And we solve this problem on 1024 process. So this is a simple Poisson problem here. But this converged nicely in 61 PCMG iteration. And so the time for building the interpolation matrix is either 0.9 or 36 seconds on how you impose the decomposition So this is a little bit technical, so I won't go into the details, but basically it works nicely to do geometric multi-grid even on rather nasty meshes. Another important point is parallel mesh adaptation. So this is done through the ParamMG plugin, which is developed at INRI at Bordeaux. And so what's really interesting in this small example is that everything is parallel. So you do mesh adaptation in parallel. You never go back to a full mesh that can be quite huge and that can be stored on a single process. So just as a benchmark, we use the Fischera corner. So this is a corner with this is a cube with a re-entering corner. We again solve a Poisson problem, so it's just for benchmarking. The problem is solved with Hyper. We do anisotropic mesh adaptation with MSHMET, and we do adaptation with ParMMG on 42 MPI processes. So we start with a rather coarse mesh made of 42,000 tetrahedra. And the time it takes is 6.2 seconds to do parallel mesh adaptation. And basically we do an iterative process. So we refine successively the mesh by having MSHMET generate a metric which is finer and finer and finer, okay? So we do multiple adaptation with ParMMG. And so at the second step, we generate somehow a finer mesh and we iterate. And so we get a finer and finer and finer mesh. And so the timings are rather good because I think, so I'm not an expert of MMG, but to refine a mesh of around 1 million tetrahedron, it can take a lot of time with MMG. And so with ParMMG, it's somehow more tractable. So of course here, the problem is simple. It's a Poisson problem. And so if you solve that using an algebraic solver like Hyper, you can see that the cumulative time for the 9 solves is 62 seconds. So it's really fast, but if you do mesh adaptation inside a more complex loop, like doing an Navier-Stokes solve, which will be much costlier, it's really nice to do parallel mesh adaptation. Okay. Non-standard eigensolvers. So in PETSI, you can have access to SLEPSI, which is basically a set of routines for doing eigenvalue problem. So for I think about 3 years we've had linear eigensolvers, so like ARPAC, and recently we've added some new eigenvalue solvers. So now you can do nonlinear eigensolver. So you can think of T being something like a rational function. So this is solved using NEP solve, so nonlinear eigenvalue problem solve. You can solve polynomial eigenvalue problem. So if you are interested, for example, in quadratic eigenvalue problem, let's say. So this is solved through the PEP solve routine. So PEP is polynomial eigenvalue problem. And we have also singular value decomposition, which are solved using SVD solve. Okay, so all those routines are basically from SLEPSI and we have their interface inside FreeFM, so you can call PEP solve on your PETSI metrics. So what's important to keep in mind is that an array of PETSI matrices is as easily defined as an array of FreeFM matrices. So in FreeFM, you can have array of matrices using matrix int, and so in PETSI it's mat int. Okay, so it's quite trivial to go from one and another. Okay, so some other tools. So in PETSI, you have ways to define matrix-free preconditioner and matrix-free operators. And so we've made this more easy to access, let's say. And so I will show you two examples. One is for solving the Hossein equations. So you have to think of the operator A being the discretization of the linearized Navier-Stokes equation. So F is the convection diffusion operator, B is the divergence-free operator, and C is basically zero if you do incompressible Navier-Stokes. And so what's really nice about FreeFM is that you can define block matrices like in MATLAB. And so there is basically a one-to-one correspondence between how you defined block matrices in FreeFM and how to define block matrices with PETSI. And so you can see it's basically exactly the same interface. So you need to use the bracket bracket operator, and then you can have different blocks, okay? And so in PETSI, these matrices are called nests, okay? So you can see that you can see the nest structure. So the block 0, 0 is the fluid block. The block 0, 1 is the, again, divergence free. And then you have the transpose, and then you have the pressure block. So if you want to define some preconditioner, matrix free preconditioner, for example, for Ozin equation, there is a quite well-known approximation of the Schur complement, which is called the PCD preconditioner. So I'm not stating that it's the best preconditioner there is out there for solving the Ozin equation, but this is just to show you how to define matrix free preconditioner. And so the PCD preconditioner basically builds a triangular block preconditioner for the operator A. So this is a block LDL, block LU factorization, triangular block factorization. And so you approximate the Schur complements by the inverse of the Laplacian on the pressure space, the convection diffusion operator on the pressure space, and the mass matrix on the pressure space. Okay, so this gives you an approximation of your Schur complement, of the inverse of the Schur complement, sorry. And so in FreeFM, this is quite trivial to do. You just need to define a func. So in FreeFM, func is basically how to define a function, which gives as an output a vector, which takes as an input another vector. And so inside this func, you just define how to apply the inverse of the Schur complement. And so in PETSI, when you solve linear system, this is called KSP solve. So the K stands for Krylov subspace. So you solve with your Laplacian, you multiply by your pressure your convection diffusion on the pressure space, and then you solve with your mass matrix. So this is the PCD preconditioner, and then PETSI has a complete set of preconditioner tools to define block preconditioner, and so these preconditioners are called field splits. And so you say, okay, I want my inverse of my Schur complement, so for the block C, to be a shell. So this is a matrix-free operator, and your shell is basically your function PCD. Okay. So this is a little bit technical if you don't know much about fluid dynamics or field split, but there are examples in the FreeFM repository to do that. I will give you the pointers afterwards. And so this was for defining a preconditioner, but you can do also the same for defining an operator. So I'll try to go quickly on these slides because Pierre-Henri will talk more about FEM-BEM coupling in the next talk. But basically, he will probably define this kind of operator, which is nothing else than the Johnson-Nedelec coupling for a finite element, boundary element method solver. So F is a finite element block, B is a boundary element block, and then you need to have operator to go from the surface to the volume, or to the volume to the surface. So either to the from the BEM to the FEM discretization, or from the BEM to the FEM discretization, okay? And so in this case, again, Pierre-Henri will talk more about this, but the B operator is a hierarchical matrix, so you don't know how to represent this using a sparse matrix in FreeFM. And the same applies to the surface to volume. So again, just as for the PCD preconditioner, you can define func, which are basically matrix-free operator. So I will skip some boilerplate code, but basically you can define all the blocks of your matrix, of your block matrix. And so you can see that then PETSI takes care of having the nice structure of a nest matrix. So for the 0, 0 block, this is the FEM part. So it's assembled as an AIJ matrix. So this is some technical detail which is not really relevant. For the 0, 1 block, so the surface to volume, so BEM to FEM, you have a shell operator. So this is a matrix-free operator So the action is computed using a hierarchical matrix. For the 1-0 block, this is the FEM to BEM operator. This is assembled using a mass matrix, so you can have an explicit representation of your matrix using an IAJ matrix. And for the BEM part, this is again a hierarchical matrix. You don't have a sparse representation, so you need to use a matrix-free operator, and this is stored as a shell in PETSI and in FreeFEM. Okay. So there are many other additions. These were mainly the most important ones, I think. You can do mixed precision arithmetic and 64-bit integers. Unlike what Atsushi will present, I don't know if it's tomorrow or this afternoon, but anyway, this is not higher precision arithmetic, this is only single precision arithmetic, whereas FreeFEM works in double precision arithmetic. And so 60-bit integer is for solving really large problem. So there are a lot of new PETSI routines, like PETSI memory get current usage. So if you want to have some memory counter in your script to know how much memory is being consumed by FreeFEM, you can do that quite easily. So some noteworthy examples. So PCD for OSIN is in OSIN 2D PETSI. FEMBEM coupling is in Helmholtz coupled to the PETSI complex. So those are the examples from the two previous slides. We've added also bilaplacian with Morley finite element. If you are interested in knowing the infsup discrete constant of the Stokes equation, there is an example, Stokes 2D SLEPSI. So if you are too lazy for doing the math and you just want to know if your scheme is stable, you can just use this script. We've added interface with PETSI DM. So these are the mesh. This is the mesh infrastructure of PETSI. So for example, if you want to deal with HDF5 mesh file, if you want to use GMSH version 4 binary files, you can use the DM, because in FreeFEM, the GMSH load is only for version 2, so on and so forth. And so I will maybe quickly mention the save load mat with different distribution. So maybe all this is a little bit too technical for you, and you may ask yourself, is it really worth doing parallel computing? So there is one really nice way to know this, is by doing these last functionalities, and so I will try to show it to you. So what we've added basically is a way to save a matrix to disk from some script and then load it in another file and maybe try a different distribution. So maybe try more processes so that you know if it's worth it or not to do parallel computing. So I will just go into a random example, tutorial. So for this example, I need something that uses VARF. So I think I've tried this on, no, Laplace RT does not, Laplace Lagrange Mult uses VARF. Okay. It actually uses MAT. Okay, so that's even better. So the first step, of course, will be to save your matrix to disk. So you can do that quite easily using, again, load PETSI. And then you need to feed your FreeFEM matrix to PETSI matrix, so output, okay? And then you can load your matrix, you can save your matrix to disk, so you do object view, output. You say that you want to store this matrix in binary format, and you say that you want this, you name your file Lagrange, let's say. Okay? So this is a sequential script in the distribution, Laplace Lagrange RT, okay? Okay, so I think I need to just make a small adjustment. So I just run my script. Again, keep in mind that even though this is a sequential script, you need to use FreeFEM++ MPI, Laplace Lagrange. Okay, so my script ran, and so I should have something. What was the name? So here you have two matrix files. So of course, don't try to open this by hand because those are binary matrices. So this is all garbage. But what's important next is that you can write a small script. And so you basically, you, in this small script, you can load your matrix that you've previously dumped. So I will just do this. So load PSIP. And so Lagrange. And so you can do matload Lagrange format equal binary and name equal Lagrange. Okay, so this should work. Okay, and so what's important now is that you can, even though you've dumped your matrix in a sequential script, you can actually load this matrix in parallel. So for example, you can do MPI run tag. And so this is interesting because you may not want to spend a couple of hours trying to parallelize your script if it's not worth it. And so first you may want to just dump the matrix, load it on file, and for example, solve a linear systems using something like Lagrange, RHS, out, okay? Lagrange.n, out, Lagrange.n. Just some stupid name, let's say, stupid variables. Okay, PC type LU. And so of course this will take a, okay, this is the ID, KSP view, let's say. Okay, so this is interesting in the sense that you have your sequential script. Okay, you've spent 2 years developing a sequential script. You don't want to spend more time developing it. So first you want to say, okay, is PETSI efficient for solving my problem? Well, you can just do this by dumping your sequential matrix to disk and then loading it in parallel to try different solver and see, oh, okay, this may be worth trying to go parallel because I can see that MUMS or whatever solver is performing much better than the default option I have in my sequential script. Okay. So now I will present some application of parallel freeform, let's say. And so the first one I will present is for doing eddy current testing. So in France, we have about 75% of our electricity produced by power plants. So it's rather important to know that they're working well and there is no immediate danger. And so we use this to do a stewardship of a steam generator inside power pressurized water reactor. And so this is a non-destructive testing mechanics where basically we have a probe in green that scans a tube, so in gray, and we want to see if there are any deposits on the tube because those deposits can lower the efficiency of the steam generator, okay? So basically we have different type of probes that are used. And what's important to keep in mind is that we have to solve an inverse problem for reconstructing deposits. And this implies solving the Helmholtz equation with multiple right-hand sides. So I'm showing you two kinds of probe that are used by the people at EDF. And so in practice, when you go into the algebraic formulation, or at least the discretized formulation, you need to solve a system of linear equation, which is AX equal B, but this time with X and B being matrices themselves, so tall and skinny matrices. And so you can use tools like block Kryloff methods, but these tools are rather memory demanding. So if you have a large number of right-hand side, it can be quite stressful on the memory. And so we have developed a technique where we basically split a block of right-hand side B into multiple smaller blocks. So B1, B2, and et cetera, until BP. And then we solve these multiple P systems using recycling coupled with blocking. So I will show some comparison in terms of performance. So the naive strategy for solving a block system is to solve right-hand side by right-hand side. So you have to define as many blocks as there are right-hand side, and your blocks are made of a single right-hand side. So if you do that, it's quite inefficient because you end up having you end up spending almost 2 hours in your linear solve for a single system. And of course, this is an inverse problem. So you need to solve multiple systems with as many right-hand side as there are there. So then you can switch to block Kryloff methods. And so you can do different parameters of blocking. So you either define 8 block, so P equal 8, or you have 4 block. And so depending on your number of blocks, you have more or less right-hand side per block, okay? And basically you can see that you can have huge speed up using block Kryloff methods. And if you couple block Kryloff methods with recycling, you get even better speed ups. And if you are interested in all the details of those kind of Kryloff strategies, you can have a look at the preprint that we just submitted. Another aspect of block preconditioner and block Kryloff method is that they can be used in some kind of eigensolvers. So for example, the locally optimal block precondition conjugate gradient method, or the contour integral spectrum slicing method. So they were developed at the beginning of the century, actually. And so we want to assess the efficiency of our tools inside FreeFM for getting the eigenvalues of the Laplacian equation. And so we are interested in the 20 lowest eigenmodes. And so you can notice by the look of the eigenvectors that we have a diffusivity coefficient kappa, which is heterogeneous. So the eigenvalues look a little bit weird at some places. This is because of the coefficient of the diffusivity coefficient. Okay, so there are multiple strategies to precondition this system. The first one we'll use is a simple additive Schwarz method. So this is a quite basic preconditioner. What it does is basically perform 54 outer iteration because it's not a really nice preconditioner. Numerically speaking, but from an algorithmic point of view, it's nice because you can call you can work on a full block of right hand side in one go. So you don't need to work column by column. You can apply the preconditioner on a full block of right hand side. So I'm reporting the timings for setting up the preconditioner. It's a really cheap preconditioner, so its setup time is quite low, and then the time for solving the linear eigenvalue problem. So then you can switch to GAMG, which is an algebraic preconditioner. So it's much more robust. So you can see that the number of outer iteration is much lower. But one problem with multi-grid preconditioner is that almost none of them can work on a full block of right-hand side. So you need to solve the system column by column. So even though you do less outer iteration, the overall solve time is actually larger. And so then we switch to a technique that we've developed inside the HPDDM package. And so it gathers both the advantage of additive Schwarz method in the sense that it can work on a full block of vector at once. And it also has the nice numerical property of multigrid-like method in the sense that it's really robust when you look at the number of outer iteration. So in this scenario, you can see that, okay, the setup cost is a little bit higher because this is you need to assemble a coarser level problem, so you have a lot of work instead of a simple ASM preconditioner, but the outer iteration is much more robust, and so it converges faster. And so in this scenario, it's actually the fastest alternative. So this slide, if you've been to the previous FreeFM days, you've seen those slides already. So we have a matrix-free radiative transfer solver developed with people from Nantes. So I won't go into the physics detail, but basically this is an integral differential problem that you need to discretize both in space and in angle. So it's a really high dimensional problem. And what we've done since last year is actually compare our solver against state-of-the-art solution. And so this can be done using the Kobayashi benchmark. So you have two sets of problems. I won't go again into the details. You can have a look at the paper if you want the details of the Kobayashi benchmark. But what's nice is that we can compare our results, so this is the DOM column, with respect to two state-of-the-art solvers. So GMVP is a Monte Carlo radiative transfer equation solver from Japan. And ARDRA is a spherical harmonics solver from Lawrence Livermore National Lab. And so for the Kobayashi benchmark, you have actually a closed formulation. So you can get the exact solution. And you can see that our method is actually somehow more close to the reference solution than the spherical harmonics. So that's nice. And so you can compare from both problem. And so in the second problem, there is no exact solution, but we can see that the free-frame solution is actually quite close to both the Monte Carlo method and the spherical harmonic solver. Some more application. I have a little bit time. I have a little bit of time. So since last year, I'm really happy that that FreeFM and especially PETSI and MMG have been using quite extensively in the field of shape optimization. And for example, here I will just present some quick numerical experiment that we've done with Florian Fepon and collaborators for doing topology optimization of heat exchanger. And so the problem that we want to solve here is how to increase the heat transferred between a cold fluid and a hot fluid, given that the two phases should not intersect one with another. So we have a constraint that the two phases should be at least 0.1 unit less of length away, let's say. So this worked quite nicely. We have a nice machinery. So for example, here is the two phases. You have in red the hot phase and in blue the cold phase. And so we have a complete shape optimization framework, which does the shape optimization. And so I will show you. So this is the mesh generated by MMG. And just to show you the optimization process, here it is. So you can see that it's fully 3D. It's multi-physics. So you have heat exchange, Navier-Stokes for the pressure, the drop of pressure between the input and the output. And I think for this problem, that's about it. So this is shape optimization at its finest, I think. And actually, there will be some more about shape optimization during the FreeFM day. So that's nice to see that it's being used quite efficiently. Okay, so I will just move. Okay, so I have a couple of minutes left, so I will just talk about this last application. We are interested in defining a robust domain decomposition preconditioner. And so in the past, we have a technique which is based on the Genio method. So this is quite technical, so I won't give all the details, but it was mostly applied to a linear problem, let's say, okay? And so we've recently made some algorithmic improvement to have FreeFM automatically assemble all the tools needed by the Genio method directly for the user. So this is detailed in a preprint that we submitted this year as well. And so it's nice because then you can use the Genio method for solving non-linear problem, for example, using SNES. So SNES are the non-linear eigenvalue problem solver from PETSI. And so in this example, I solved the Bratou equation. So this is non-linear because there is an exponential in the strong formulation. And so this worked quite nicely, and the preconditioner is automatically assembled for the user, so there is nothing to do. And you can see that the Genio framework works quite well for this kind of non-linear problem. Okay, so these are the different convergence histories of the successive linearized systems. Okay, so I've given you a quick overview of what has been implemented in FreeFM with respect to parallel computing at the beginning. Then I gave you some applications. And of course, if you want to see more, during the FreeFM days, actually, there will be at least 4 talks using FreeFM and PETSI. So Haikun will present. So I'm sorry if I'm mispronouncing the name, sorry. So Haikun will present a solver using PETSI for eigenvalue problems. Hao will present another technique for doing shape optimization. And actually, you will see also that he's using a somehow a different framework, but it's quite efficient. And again, it's using PETSI and FreeFM for doing nice multiphysics application. Georges will present FreeVol. So again, this is kind of multiphysics and at least non-trivial if you look at it from a mathematical point of view, but it's behaving quite nicely with PETSI and with FreeFM. And Javier will present some application of the SLEPC and PETSI interface for doing sensitivity analysis for Navier-Stokes equation. So a lot of multiphysics, a lot of large-scale problem. And so I think the author will tell me if I'm wrong, but I think that most of these applications would not be possible using standard FreeFM. And so at some point, you need to go to FreeFM Parallel, FreeFM MPI, okay, and PETSI or SLEPC. So just a quick conclusion. I've presented you the interaction between FreeFM and PETSI slash SLEPSI. What's really nice compared to other finite element kernel like DEEL or Phoenix or FireDrake is that you can still have the very high level of abstraction of FreeFM play really nicely with the versatility of PETSI. So it may look a little bit tough at the first sight, but in practice, you can quickly learn, and I think the learning curve is not that high. What's really important is you have a very nice composability of solvers. So if you spend countless hours developing a nice linear solver, and then instead of solving a linear problem, you want to solve either a non-linear problem or an eigenvalue problem, you can just take your PETSI KSP and plug that inside your non-linear or eigenvalue problem solver. The same goes for people, for example, who have industrial software. You can try to prototype your solver inside FreeFM, and then the options are quite natural to extend to your other solver if you use in PETSI. So it's nice. You don't have to throw anything away. You can just reuse the option. And so for the people who want to learn more about FreeFM or the parallel interface, I will talk more about this during this afternoon, but there is also a sequential part. So it's not only related to FreeFM MPI and PETSI, but you can just go to this URL, which basically will prompt you to this page. So there are there are some examples, and there is a PDF which explains this in great detail. So the PDF is quite long. It's about 270 pages, but you get all the history behind FreeFM, PETSI, the interface between both, and some domain decomposition methods, so on and so forth. Okay, so I'm done for the presentation, and I think it's either questions or coffee break.
Ok, merci Pierre. On a un petit peu de temps pour les questions, au moins 5 minutes.
Moi, j'aurais une question, s'il vous plaît. C'est Lorenzo qui parle.
Oui.
J'avais en tête qu'on pouvait faire les interpolations en faisant des formulations variationnelles entre différents espaces, quoi, un peu.
Oui.
Et yes. Du coup, là... la partie sur l'interpolation du début, du coup, j'ai pas très bien saisi par rapport à faire des formulations variationnelles et puis à les discrétiser en PETSI, etc. C'est pareil, c'est plus rapide, c'était pas la bonne façon de faire avant.
Ok. Tu parles dans une VAREF?
Ouais.
Ok. Alors, je vais juste me permettre de reformuler en anglais parce que ça intéresse peut-être des...
Pardon.
No, but easy. So Lorenzo was asking if, so there is one way also to interpolate from one FF space to another, and it's to use a varf using different finite element spaces. And so he was asking if it's the proper way or not. So I will just answer that it's some other way. So if you do that, even if you do that in sequential, you will end up basically by assembling a rectangular matrix. It can be square if you have the same number of degrees of freedom, but I think you get the idea. So you can also do that in PETC. And I think this will actually, so the difficulty is that is there some difficulty? Overall, what it so under the hood, there will be probably the same thing happening. The main difficulty is that, for example, if you want to use a PCMG, so the geometric multigrid, you have to assemble a Galerkin projection operator. So this is the equivalent of the interpolate. So you need to assemble a matrix for interpolating. So you cannot do that through a varf. And so if you have a distributed varf, I think you can get exactly the same result. So I think you can, but I prefer to use this approach because it's slightly more flexible. Does that answer your question?
Yes, thank you.
Okay. I see that Alexei Lozinski is asking what version of FreeFM is advised for the advanced tutorial. So this is one really one nice thing. Since version 4.6, I think, all the binaries, so .exe, .dmg, .deb, they all come with PETC, SLEPC, MMG, ParMMG, everything. So you can use, so it's advised to use the latest version, 4.7-1, as Frederick said this morning. But I think if you have something like 4.6, it should work as well.
Okay, no more questions. So, bravo Pierre. C'est vraiment impressionnant ta conf. I say that in French because it's more simple for me. Maybe we make a short coffee break because you have no coffee. So, I have coffee, but so you can take your own coffee. I'm sorry, no croissant this year. But I expect next year we can invite you to have croissant and pain au chocolat in Paris for the third FreeFM Day. The 13th FreeFM Day. The 13th FreeFM Day, sorry. Okay, so
we start in 10 minutes.
Je vais donner la main. I will give the main, the stuff to Pierre-Henri to be co-animator.